Hello and welcome to KDAB News, the monthly update for professionals working with Qt, C++, and 3D technologies. I'm Robert Brock, and in this edition, we'll mainly go over the latest news about an interview with Mike Krus, senior software developer of KDAB, who tells us about Qt 3D in Qt 6, a glimpse under the hood of the new Unu Scooter UI, Minecraft's improved CMake build system, a new section inspired by one of our viewers, Library of the Month. Thank you for that. Announcements and resources. In the previous edition, we already looked at what's going on in Qt 6. Today, we want to throw a light source on what Qt 3D will bring along in Qt 6. I'm happy to speak with Mike Krus, who is deeply involved in the development of Qt 3D. Hi, Mike. Nice to speak with you. Could you run us through what's new?
Well, for Qt 3D in Qt 6 timelines, you'll notice there's a certain number of changes that we've introduced. The first one that you're likely to notice is that Qt 3D no longer ships as a precompiled module. You need to build it from source yourself. So the source gets installed by the maintenance tool, and then you need to compile Qt 3D yourself. There's actually Conan recipes that ship with Qt 3D to make this process easier for all the, that includes platforms such as mobile platforms and cross-compiling for embedded systems. So that's the first change. We've continued otherwise in terms of changes to the library Qt 3D itself. We've continued a lot of the work that we've been doing on optimization to make Qt 3D faster. And some of those new features actually come from introducing new APIs, in particular when it comes, for example, to let the user specify bounding volumes for the loaded object so that Qt 3D doesn't need to calculate themselves. That kind of things, be able to provide alternate geometries, both for bounding volume calculations and for picking, and a few other sort of user-facing changes that we have introduced. But the main change that people are more likely to be interested in is that Qt 3D's rendering backend has been made improved with a plugin API, and we've isolated basically all the pre-existing OpenGL rendering code into a plugin, and we are introducing a new plugin which uses a library called RHI, which was a rendering hardware interface, which was made by it's part of Qt Base, and what it is, it's basically wraps the 3D rendering libraries such as Metal, Vulkan, OpenGL, DirectX, and basically provides quick access and fast hardware accelerated rendering on the best possible library that you have on your platform. So on the Mac, it will target Metal, on the Windows, it will target DirectX, and so on. So Qt 3D has this new rendering backend, which is the default. You don't need to set anything. It will use that, and it will then, via RHI, target Metal, Vulkan, and so on for even faster rendering.
Mm-hmm. That sounds great. Faster rendering will always be great for productivity. What issues or challenges did you run into?
Some of the challenges we've had with introducing this new release of Qt 3D, there's been a few. There's the new distribution method, which is a change in the way we do things. Mostly, the harder topic was introducing the RHI-based backend. So RHI was designed to replace the Qt Quick Renderer, which is, you know, a very specific type of renderer for mostly 2D applications. It has a specific feature set in terms of those textures that it supports, for example, and so on. All of these means that because RHI was designed for that, it has those inherent limitations. And because Qt 3D is a much more generic rendering library, it has some issues, it has some limitations when using the RHI backend. Some of those we've been able to work around, some of those are still known limitations. So for example, if you have the RHI backend, you don't have access to geometry shaders, some texture formats are not supported, and so on.
I see. So just a few things to keep in mind. And what's next?
So going forward, the things that we want to do is basically work around some of those RHI limitations, either by improving RHI itself or by implementing alternate support in Q3D. One of the things we will be also looking at, since we now have a plugin-based rendering backend, is be able to introduce other backend plugins, potentially to target directly Vulkan or directly Metal, so that we have access to the full feature set of those libraries without having to go through the limitations of RHI. So that's something we're going to look at over the weeks and months to come.
Excellent. So we know what to keep an eye out for. Thanks for that, Mike. Software plays a more and more important role when it comes to developing modern and sustainable solutions for urban mobility. KDAB has been working closely together with UNU to create the dashboard application for their next generation of electric scooters that has recently come to the market. It has been a challenge to integrate all the different functionalities and services in one dashboard and keep it clean and simple at the same time. Among them are a service for communicating with the engine, a service for dealing with the batteries, a service for communicating with the cloud, or the actual dashboard that will be able to show you the navigation while driving. All of these services need to communicate with each other as well. So, for example, the dashboard needs to be able to show the speed of the engine while also showing the battery charge. If you'd like to learn more about the internals of such a dashboard application and how the developers solved these tasks, I recommend this comprehensive blog right here. By the way, if you want to find out more about these affordable, innovative urban scooters and book a test drive, check out the link below the video. Kitware announced that they helped Minecraft to improve their CMake build system. In the course of this collaboration, a number of improvements to CMake itself have been made, among which an option to CMake's Unity build support that allows you to explicitly specify how source files should be grouped together. Taught CMake how to generate Visual Studio projects for Android, and interface libraries can now have source files associated with them. This makes it easier to organize groups of source files in your IDE. You can find the full article, including the list of improvements, below. As mentioned in the beginning, this new section came to life thanks to one of our viewers. So each month I'll tell you about a library or tool that our developers use. So we start with this one. Many times we need to distribute an update to our applications, be it a new version or an add-on. While there are probably countless libraries, including one KDAB wrote, KDUpdater, that help with this and integrated solutions in the operating systems, sometimes a simple solution is what we need. For Qt, there is a nice small library called QSimpleUpdater with an interesting license. The usage is really simple, provided JSON metadata describing the available update and location from where you can download it. The library can then check if the metadata offers a new version and offer to download it when there is one. The library is also flexible enough and lets you handle what to do with the downloaded data. This is where we could write code that installs the updates using different methods on different platforms. Our experience is positive, and we will probably use it for more and more in-house applications to distribute updates easily for everyone, be it on Linux, Windows, or Mac. For our German-speaking viewers who work in embedded development, the upcoming ESE Congress might be of interest. From 30th of November until the 4th of December, there will be keynotes, talks, and seminars around embedded software engineering. Among those, a talk by our KDAB colleague Anton Kruskamp about tailored code refactoring with Clang tooling. The program will be mainly in German. On the 4th and 5th of December, there will be the CPP Summit in Shenzhen, China. Among the speakers there, we'll have our own Ivan Chukic. And further, there will be two virtual Qt events organized by the Qt company. First, about desktop on the 10th of December, and the second about design on the 21st of January. As always, you will find all links about the events below the video. In our resources, manual testing of user interfaces in applications is often a very complex and error-prone activity. Squish is a proven GUI test automation tool for functional GUI regression tests. Companies in all types of industries, including KDAB, use Squish to reduce the time spent on GUI testing software releases while increasing the quality of their applications. If you want to learn more on how to use Squish in your project, a new online training is now available called Testing Qt with Squish. Check out the dates and information below. Thanks for watching. Stay safe, and as usual, feel free to share any feedback or questions below the video. See you next time.